Well, again, thank you very much for joining us at 4 o'clock, 4:30 California time. I know those time differences can be rough.
In the morning, yes.
Yes, often I'll get messages from my mom at 3 a.m. as she forgets the time difference. So community resilience, I think, is a good discussion to have as we talk about life and what happens. Our journey started in September of 2019, but obviously as the co-founder of this model, this has been a lifelong journey for you. So it'd be great if you could just give us a summary, as much as you can. I know sometimes that can be a challenge to sum up a lifetime of work in a few moments, but if you could just talk to us about the community resilience model and really the inspiration behind why you started it, because there are so many models out there. And so just to really hear from you, your inspiration and what it is.
It's my joy to do that. You know, I just want to say my last international trip in 2019, I traveled like 120,000 miles on American Airlines. And my last international trip was to Belfast. So I have to say Belfast is always in my heart. And here I am talking to you from California. And I agree with your previous speaker that this there has been a silver lining and having to change things to Zoom. And we certainly in our organization have reached more people, I think, during this last year because of having to change everything that we had done in the past. But I say the community resiliency model, first of all, people have always asked me, well, what do you do when you go around the world, Elaine? I said, well, you know, I think it sums up by I try to help people to invite them to be able to tell the difference between sensations of distress and sensations of well-being. And so, for example, when Jeanine was talking about, you know, when the internet goes down, I mean, we can't control, there's so many things in the world that we can't control, but sometimes when that happens, we might get pushed into what we call the high zone. We might get frayed. I mean, I've certainly happened to me before going, oh my gosh, am I gonna get everybody back online again? I've got all these people waiting for me. And if we get into that high zone for too long a period of time, and certainly there's so many things in life, you know, the pandemic, I mean, COVID is just, has many of us are suffering. And I wanna say that as I get started, I know that many people have lost individuals. We just lost someone in our community that was only 46. So there's been a lot of suffering in the world, but that we can shoot us into the high zone. And sometimes then we can only stay there so long before it puts us right down in the low zone. We feel disconnected, depressed, and like, I don't wanna do anything. And so when I'm starting out with that, those are some common terminology that if we have a common language to talk about the lived experiences being humans, it can help us. And so the community resiliency model, I can now say we're evidence informed, we're research informed. We have people all over the world doing research about the model, but the model consists of six very simple wellness skills. It can be used with little children. It can be used with elders. My father-in-law who died 2 years ago was 105. And I used to ask him, well, you know, Kenny, I know your knees are hurting right now, but you know, you've got really strong arms. You push that walker all around our house. And he'd like move his hands up and down. And he goes, I do have strong arms. And all of a sudden you could just see kind of the pain, the perception of the pain, like turn down a notch. It didn't take it away, but it turned down a notch. So basically the wellness skills are really designed to help you to be able to tell the difference between sensations of distress and well-being. And once you can do that, you have a choice. You have a choice to say, am I gonna stay with those distressing sensations? Or can I start paying attention to those sensations that are about my well-being? And I'm using the word sensations because in the community resiliency model, that's the foundation. You know, as human beings, we have all these different portals of how we get information, what we think, what we feel, but also what we sense. And there is a growing body of research that the scientists call it interoceptive awareness. And when people can have that interoceptive awareness and they can cultivate it, they can get their life back on track again through that sensory system. And then it's kind of one of my friends said yesterday, I have a new talk show on Voice America called Resiliency Within. And we were talking before the show and she said, well, it's as if when you learn the skills, it gives you a pause. And it's kind of like you reach up into your prefrontal cortex and pull it down and say, oh, what else is true? And I loved what your previous speaker, Nina, said. You know, we have to remember all those things that also have happened this year that have been things where we've learned and we've grown, but that's also part of the community resiliency model. You know, I have been to Belfast. I mean, I feel so honored because people have shared with me about the suffering that happened during the Troubles conflict and the suffering that goes on now. And knowing that when we can learn to bring this other lens into our consciousness and bring it into our body, and then it comes back up to the mind, we feel better. And we also, with the community resiliency model, have greater self-compassion. And guess what happens when we have greater self-compassion? If I'm upset with you, Jolena, I might feel, oh, well, you know, she's gone through a hard week this week. I need to have compassion towards her. It makes me have a different lens. So instead of maybe the distorted lens that I think trauma can sometimes bring to us, it opens up our vista to also what may be true about our interpersonal relationships. So you asked me about, you know, how did this all start? Well, first of all, you never start something by yourself. You know, I always say I stand on the shoulders of so many people that have come before me. And I certainly did a lot of reading as a social worker and as a trauma therapist about how trauma impacts the body. And at that time, when I was learning all that, I was a teacher of family medicine. So I worked in a very large family practice residency program. In fact, one of the largest in the state, since in San Bernardino County, which is the largest geographical county in the United States. But I would be what we called it co-attending with the medical faculty. So my job was to bring to the young doctors. They'd come and go, oh, well, the person can't sleep. They get Ambien. I said, oh, I wonder what's happening in that person's life. You have to go back in now and find out what's happening. Well, almost invariably, when someone was having a problem sleeping, it had to do with trauma and stress. And so linking those up to young doctors and say, well, how can I help them understand? Because they'd say, oh, there's a social worker always talking about the emotions. I said, well, not really. Emotions are part of it, but there's something more. So when I started reading about the neuroscience of trauma in the body, I go, it was kind of like that amen, hallelujah moment. Oh, the residents will get the autonomic nervous system. I can talk to them about, you know, the fancy term of the HP axis, which is our stress response. Mm-hmm. And they know that already because they learned it in medical school and they see it, how it manifests in people. But if I said, well, what if you had something very simple where you could help your patients get back into their zone? And yesterday on my talk show, there was a wonderful doctor, Dr. Debbie Small, who I met 20 years ago when she was a baby intern. She's now an associate program director of that same hospital. And she told this story. She was telling, and this is like, what this is the one of the answers related to your question is that she said, well, Elaine was teaching me all these things. And she said, I had a person who was in hypertensive crisis in the hospital. And so, you know, the lovely nurses were doing guided imagery. And the nurse said, well, you know, I just tried to take her to the beach, but, you know, it's not helping. And we tried all these medications. And so Dr. Small said, I'm going to go in and try what Elaine's taught me. So she went in and she said, well, you know, we're really concerned about your hypertension. She says, well, that nurse is really nice, but I can't swim. So she was taking me to the beach and she goes, I just get nervous thinking about the beach, right? And so one of the things about the community resiliency model is the invitation. And so that's what the invitation to your own treasures and resources for yourself. And so Dr. Small asked her, she goes, well, is there a place that you can think of that you feel calm or good or happy or better? And she goes, my couch. And then this woman described her couch in her house. And Dr. Small said, you can just see her just start to relax. So she said, I call the nurse in. She goes, take her blood pressure. See if it's any better. She said, it was her amen, hallelujah moment was, it was normal. So, I mean, this mind and body are connected. And so these little simple interventions, I said, well, how long did you spend with this person? You know, I've talked to her about this before. And she, you know, it was like 15 minutes. So it didn't take long. And I think, I'm not saying that the community resiliency model is the begin and end of everything, but when we can help our clients, when we can help ourselves, you know, your previous guest was talking about self-care. I mean, I use these skills all the time. I get bumped out a lot. I've had my granddaughter and my daughter and son-in-law live in our house since the pandemic. And it used to be just me and my husband. And sometimes I can go, oh, I'm getting into my high zone. I got to ground myself. so that I can show up as my best self. So these self-regulation skills, I like to think about it. It's like, if I'm going to go into the worst storm of my life, I want to make sure I got a backpack full of goodies that are going to help me get through it. And I think that the community resiliency model skills are part of what can help all of us get through those storms of life. And I, you know, when all of you to know, I'm a trauma therapist. So people go, well, are you saying that our trauma therapy is no longer important? Absolutely not. But I think what we've seen and why we called it the community resiliency model is that this is an intervention for the world, for all of us. And as you know, because we've trained a number of people in your organization and in Belfast, we teach the natural leaders of communities and the who can already have a great deal of skills to add a few that are based on neuroscience into their toolbox so that they can help the people that they love, whether it's their family, their community, whether it's their church group, whether, you know, it's working with survivors like your wonderful organization does, that these tools can help people get back into what we call the resilient zone or the okay zone so they can negotiate what happens to them in life. I know that was kind of a long answer to that question.
No, that was brilliant. It's hard to know when to when to stop with an answer, because there is so much that can be said about the model and about the benefits of the model. And I have to say, for us in our journey, which I'll talk about in just a bit, it really, part of the attraction was that simplicity that you're talking about, those skills of being able to say to someone, I know this is difficult, and I know that this trauma is part of your story now. Here's some tools that we can give you that are very straightforward, that are invitational, as you said. And I remember in my training talking about a roller coaster as part of a descriptor, and one of the trainers talking to me about, well, not everyone loves roller coasters, whereas I find it a very pleasant experience, whereas other people, right. So I might be talking to someone about a roller coaster and I'm completely bumping them out and not even realizing it, because I find it very enjoyable, whereas they find it terrifying. So I think that is such an important part of it. So thank you very much. So today, you know, we've really been talking about the trauma experienced by people who have been survivors of sexual abuse, sexual violence. And one of the very first speakers was touched on very much those responses that we have, you know, that fight, freeze type of response that we have, and how our body reacts, which is one of those things that I think is such an important component of this model, is understanding that it's biology and not weakness, which is one of the quotes that I love from your program, is there are things that our body does because it is trying to survive, and it is not about our logical brain. It is about that moment in time when your body is going, this is what needs to be done just to survive this. And so this is what I'm doing. And your logical brain has no part in it. So when we're thinking about that, could you talk to us about why you think that this particular model and these wellness skills can bolster the resilience in people who have experienced trauma like sexual assault and or abuse? Because it is one of those things where you're talking about, it is for a community, it is for all of us. And in these particular experiences, there's something so violating about these types of experiences. And it, on the surface, when you're looking at this, you're kind of going, well, these seem quite simple, basic tools for something that is a serious trauma. And as you say, we're not replacing trauma counseling or trauma therapy, but this is certainly a step in that journey. And it'd be great to just to hear from you why you feel like it would address this particular area of trauma.
Well, first of all, and I also want to add to the fight, flight, freeze, tend and befriend. And I think especially is important for sexual assault survivors, because sometimes when you make that quick decision that, oh, they're bigger than me, I can't fight them, I can't run away, the freeze response somehow hasn't come in, you might say, well, would you like some dinner? And then later on, if you're in the judicial system, they say, well, you really consented to that, which I think, and this is a tend and befriend, is something that that all of us could do. Children certainly do it, but women do it more than men do, even though there's some men that do it, that I think it's important to add that, because I've certainly seen a lot of shame that happens in survivors saying, well, why did I do that? Why did I, you know, why did I give that person this or that? But that's also part, I think, of really a response that we have as women, who often were the ones who took care of children, who tried to create safety in the group when we had the marauders that were coming in from the neighboring village that wanted to take us over. We said, well, how can we survive, and how can our social group survive? So I think that's just, I just wanted to add that little piece. But I think what's important, as one sexual assault survivor told me once, she goes, Elaine, it's been so helpful to know that I have these multi-sensory reminders of what happened to me, because that's what derails my life. So if I'm in the grocery store and I'm in the freezer section and all of a sudden I smell a certain cologne, now I know that's connected to my assailant. All of a sudden I would start experiencing fear, like going into that high zone that we talked about. And I'd go, I need to get the heck out of here. But I wouldn't know why. So what you just explained in terms of the neuroscience piece, I think having that psychoeducation that we as human beings are designed to survive. We have that part of our brain called the amygdala, or I call her Amy G for short. And that she is there to say, oh my goodness, this happened to you before, run like hell, get the heck out of here. Or sometimes the freeze response, right, increases our chances of survival. So we may be in situations after the fact where those same responses can get triggered inside of our body. And when that happens, maybe all of a sudden we're angry at someone. We're going, why am I so angry? Because it's not necessarily this person, but what we're generalizing from what's happened to us in the past, and that hasn't gotten digested out of our system. So these multi-sensory reminders, we in the community resiliency model, learning these skills, we intercept the hijacking of our nervous system, because that the amygdala is really beautifully designed to say, I need to keep you safe. And that cologne is when you almost died. And that's why I'm triggering that response. If it could talk, that's what it would say. But it happens in a nanosecond. And you know that, and I still remember this one woman saying, walking outside my house is like there are landmines everywhere. And so sometimes it's just easier to stay inside. But once that person learned that she could start sensing her body and go, oh, that's what that is. And then shift her awareness to say, oh, but I can ground, I can sense that well-being. And you know this, Jolena, because you're a trainer, right? That well-being expands and grows, and that it can start to override those reminders that are not serving you in the here and now. And that's what I think what learning the skills does. It reminds us to be in the present moment, but with very tangible skills that can be used by everyone or anyone, from cradle to grave, I often say, because even a person who's dying can use these skills, because you can sit and have a conversation about, you know, what their life was like, and they can have those few moments of respite, of thinking about, you know, their children or something in their life that sustained them. So there's so many different ways that these skills can be interwoven to be helpful. But with sexual assault survivors, being able to start to be able to tell the difference between sensations of distress and well-being can be a life-altering experience without necessarily, and this is a thing that as an old trauma therapist could be blasphemous. You know, there are some folks that don't ever want to go and talk to a therapist about what happened to them, but they want to be able to go to the market. They want to be able to raise their kids, and they want to be able to, you know, go for a walk without always being in fear. And so when people start to learn how to manage their nervous system, that they can get aspects of their life that were taken away from them, from what happened to them. So that's what excites me. And I used to say about the community resiliency model, because we have two models, the other one's the trauma resiliency model, which is directed towards mental health professionals, that these were our wellness skills, and the trauma reprocessing was the trauma resiliency model. And one very smart psychiatrist said to me once, and I go, oh my gosh, you're so right. She says, Elaine, you are trauma reprocessing with the community resiliency model, but it's the body sensations that you're reprocessing, not the narrative of the story. I do believe stories are important, but I've also seen where stories aren't necessarily helpful for everyone, because you, maybe all the listeners have heard the stories over and over and over again, but sometimes that doesn't get the person out of the looping or the kind of the road that is all about how they define themselves in terms of the trauma and not in terms of what else is true and what else has happened in your life, which can be so plentiful. But if we only are there with those multi-sensory reminders, it's pretty hard to get off that road.
Thank you very much. I apologize if there's any background noise. Obviously, working from home means that I have no control over what my neighbors do, but
I did not hear anything.
Oh, good. Thank you very much for that answer. I think for me, everything that you're saying is, it just resonates so much as we've been on this journey within our own organization. And I think, you know, just what you were saying there about how walking outside your home, it's like you're navigating a minefield, which I think, you know, for many victims, it can feel that way, regardless of what the particular crime might be, or anyone who's experienced trauma, regardless of what that trauma is. Sometimes that feels, you know, impossible to be able to step outside your door without feeling like you're in danger, and how right. hard and difficult that must be to live your life in that way. And so I know, I think for us in particular, as we've been adapting CRM to our practice and our work within our organization, that has been very valuable to us in understanding the reactions of people as they come into us, and dealing with adults who have experienced sexual violence, and now with our new service for children who have been victims of sexual violence, you know, being able to navigate some of those conversations within our context, which isn't counseling. I think CRM has given us some really valuable tools, because I know that one of the reasons that we adapted it as an organization was because obviously our staff are reaching out to people and talking to people, and while we are engaging with them on a counseling or therapy level, even the amount of the story or the narrative that we do hear can often be very hard for staff to process themselves without experiencing some of that secondary trauma.
Absolutely. And I often think that people that have chosen the fields that we're in, they have a really high empathy quotient inside of them. So that means that when you hear the stories of others, and we know through mirror neurons that we suffer as well. So having skills for, you know, kind of putting our oxygen mask on ourselves and tracking, and also noticing that after, if we've had an encounter where we have heard a difficult story, that we might say, well, what's happening inside of us? So that we come into our present moment awareness and can restore some of our balance, so that we can, because we might, then there's another person waiting for us. So there's, you know, not everyone is in the field like ours, where they may hear one traumatic story maybe once a month or once a year, where we're hearing over and over. And especially, I know, for whether it's an adult or a child, but I think it's especially hard for many of us for children. But I want you all to know that children can learn these skills. And can I just tell you one little teeny story?
Please do.
You know, we have a project with the C Learning Program, Social mm-hmm. Emotional Ethical Learning Program out of Emory University, which was inspired by His Holiness the Dalai Lama. And I know he comes to Ireland quite a bit. When he was traveling, he would come to see you all there in Ireland. But the story that I have to tell is that our community resiliency model is integrated into the C Learning Program as chapter 2. And I had the honor to go to India in 2019 when we had the launch of it. And my job, along with one other person, was to interview the children. And we wanted to find out from them, well, what did you like about the C Learning Program? And you can imagine my pride when the children going, we like chapter 2. Chapter 2 was the community resiliency model, right? And so I asked one little boy, I said, well, what did you like about it? And I have to tell you, I mean, I often have tears in my eyes when I say this story, but this young boy, he was about 11. He said, well, you know, I used to live in the slums in Dharamsala. He goes, and my, you know, one of his parents had died and the other one was a drug addict. And he said, and sometimes I get really sad. He said, because I really miss my two brothers who still live there. And he says, I really would like to see them. And he goes, but the sadness just kind of overwhelms me. But he goes, now, he goes, and at my school, we have these murals all over the school of the Help Now strategies of the of chapter 2 or the community resiliency model. He goes, my teachers, they let me get out of my chair and I go and I push against the wall. And he goes, and he went like this and he said, And I can feel the sadness start to drain. I can feel, sense the sadness start to drain out of my arms. And he goes, and it just drains out enough so I can go back into the classroom yes. and study. Oh my gosh. I just thought that was
That's
so
amazing.
Because how could you take away the sadness completely? But it can be enough where he could come back, kind of pull into that prefrontal cortex and do what he wants to do. And he knows that his learning is a really important part of his present and his future. So I can't say enough that we have a lot of little modules now in the community resiliency model about how to bring this to kids and how important. I mean, just imagine if we can teach children how to manage this nervous system of theirs, how their lives might be different as they negotiate whatever windstorms happen to them in their life. So I'm so grateful that you have added you. That.
That's a beautiful story. Thank you. Thank you, Elaine. We're probably reaching towards the end of our time, but just before we go, we've been talking a lot about the skills, but haven't actually named any of the skills. So there's six skills in the program and grounded by the foundational skills of tracking and grounding. And I think for me, if we could just kind of end the conversation, but the skills that you consider the foundational skills, could you just give us probably yeah. just a little bit of a summary of like why these three skills? Why are these the foundational skills?
Okay, and so I think all the skills are helpful, but when I talk about, well, if you're going to call it the community resiliency model, you have to at least invite people to learn the first three skills. Yeah. And the tracking, which is also just reading your nervous system, is learning to tell the difference between sensations of distress and well-being, which for some people can be difficult because some of us who've had a lot of trauma, all we sense is numbness. And so mm-hmm. when you say, oh, well, do you notice something? They go, what? No, I don't notice anything. But I want you all to know that no matter if you are in that situation, you know, if you go outside in wherever you live and it's cold, that's your sensory system. What's telling you that it's cold? You know to put a sweater or a jacket on so that you can cultivate that awareness. So I just want to say that. So that's foundational. So we read the nervous system with every skill. The second skill, the best way to learn how to read your nervous system is through your personal resource. So Jolena, do you have a personal resource that you can call up for a second just to share with us?
I do. This is, I think because we've been doing training sessions. So the one off the top of my head is the resource that I talk about most is a memory that I have from childhood, where my mom would, before we would go to sleep, we would sit in her grandmother's rocking chair. So it was an old wooden rocking chair and we would sit in front of our wood burning stove and she would sing hymns to me. As she rocked me back and forth to sleep. And so I particularly like that resource because it has a lot of sensations associated with it. So when I'm talking to people about it, I talk about the warmth of the fire on my feet.
Can I just ask you for just a second? Like
yes.
Right now, present moment, as you told us about this wonderful memory, are you noticing the warmth right now or not?
I always get that fuzziness and it starts in the middle of my chest and then it just kind of like flows down to my feet. It is always that resource. It's always the one that I use to show how rich a resource can be. Because I always, one of the other things I always talk about is like a resource doesn't have to be rich. It can just be something as simple as when I used to live in a town called Port Stewart, which was on the beach. And every night when I got home, the best part of my day was taking my dogs out to the beach and just letting them run along the beach as the sunset came down and hearing the ocean lapping against the shore and the feeling the sand in my toes and just watching the dogs and how happy they were.
Look at the resource are just flowing yeah. at you. I say it's the cream rising to the top. So can you notice what's happening inside as you're even telling us about the next story? What happens inside now?
It is, it's that thing of, when I think about that, I instantly become happy. So the resource about my mother is definitely about comfort and warmth and coziness. The ones about the dogs is about, you know, just happiness and satisfaction and, you know, kind of that thing.
Happiness, though, this is important. Uh-huh. Where does happiness land in the body?
For me, it's always my knees and my kind of my legs, like the tops of my legs, which is always that weird thing because you always kind of think of like, traditional sayings about, oh, it's always the in the stomach where you your seat of your emotions is in your heart and your stomach and stuff. But for me, it's always kind of like the tops of my thighs and my shoulders. But my they just get really fuzzy, which is just always a very odd feeling.
I'm going to just invite you right now to notice. Are you sensing that right now in your knees?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Okay,
so I'm just going to invite you to do that. So the important thing too is to know that we're all very different. And so where we sense the well-being, you know, can be surprising. I had one woman who had fibromyalgia once say, I can sense well-being right here, this one spot. That's it. I go, okay, well, as you touch it, what happens? Because I think what when you talk about that, and it's really important for all of you to know that resourcing with tracking, that it's one of the ways that you can cultivate your well-being. And the more that you spend the time to have those little resiliency pauses, we call them, right? To do that, that can be helpful. So the third skill I want to make sure we have time to talk about, which is grounding, that many of us learn grounding skills. But the important thing I think about the way we share them is that you can ground sitting down. You can ground standing up against a wall. You can ground with your feet. I ground with my hand a lot because I do a lot of presentations. Sometimes I get nervous and I'll put my hand on my table. And I've done it so much that I go immediately into a parasympathetic response. But grounding is really that awareness of the present moment. So when we're in that present moment, we're now out there looking in the future and the past. We're right here. Like right now, I have nothing more than what's happening in this moment with all of you, which is something very nice to me. And I can sense that warmth in my heart that I'm just here talking to people in Ireland, one of my favorite places in the world that I hope I can go back to. But the grounding is important. But I just want to emphasize, give choice if you're sharing this, because I have met people that have been tortured in chairs. So if you say, oh, can you bring your attention to how you're sitting in the chair and your feet on the ground, they go into a traumatic flashback. When we give choice, oh, you can sit anywhere you'd like. You could sit, you can lay on your bed, you can stand against the wall, you can sense your feet, you know, on the ground or not, because there's lots of things about grounding that it has to come through the feet. And there are some folks, and also remember, we're talking also about sexual assault survivors, that some people who've been assaulted, they've braced themselves because of something that's happened. And that bracing can be a sensory reminder of their assault. So bringing attention to the feet sometimes is the last thing we'd want to do, because it can be, it can overwhelm the nervous system. And I think the other thing about the basic three, if we can teach those can be part of, you know, your backpack of well-being that you can always pull out if there's distress. Now, I always like to say there's the basic three and plus one more. Let's help now. And
yes,
the help strategies are very simple. I mean, they're pushing against the wall, they're naming colors. You're actually engaging the prefrontal cortex or your proprioceptive system, because we know that if we move the large muscles of the arms and legs, it can down-regulate if you're in the high zone or up-regulate if you're in the low zone. And those are so simple, and we have seen them. We do a lot of work in schools, for example. Oh my God, teachers love them. And because they can help children who sometimes can really in an instant go into the higher low zone, get back into their resilient zone. And you can do activities with kids or with adults for that matter, that you're doing something that is the same activity that's helping those that are in the high and the low zone come back into their resilient zone. And I want to say one thing about the resilient zone, because sometimes people think, oh, is that your happy place? It can be, but that's not all that it is. The resilient zone is your well-being. And the well-being can be, I can be, like one little boy once said to me, oh, you mean I can be okay sad and okay mad? I said, yeah. And you all know the difference between if you're really angry and you get in the high zone, you kind of lost your head, right? We even have colloquialisms that go along that way, right? And if you're in the low zone, you can get, you know, scared stiff or just feel like you can't move. So it's important to know that there is a part of that resilient zone where you can be okay sad and you're not being swept away by the river of sorrows. So that's part of our humanity. That's part of our vitality, that we can stay within the zone and have different emotions and feelings and not show up as our best self. I don't want to lose that I can be, my dear friend has died from COVID. I'm sad.
Yeah.
But I haven't been so sad that I can't do the things I need to do in life. And there are times that I can, that certain life experiences have put me in the low zone. But isn't it nice to know that we can come back up again? Because I think life becomes problematic in terms of our common language if we get stuck in the higher low zone. So the skills, the basic three, help now, very simple, can get us back into our, you know, our, we show up as our best self.
That's great, Elaine. Thank you so much. I could sit here and talk to you all day. Unfortunately, we do have to wrap it up now.